ओम वक्रतुंड महाकाय सूर्यकोटिसमप्रभ निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा। सरस्वती नमस्तुभ्यं वरदे कामरूपिणी विद्यारंभं करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा। गुरवे सर्वलोकानां एवरोगिणां हृदये सर्वविद्यानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शङ्करं लोकशङ्करम्। साक्षात्कृतं दयानन्दं परमार्थस्वरूपिणं तत्त्वज्ञानप्रशास्तारं प्रणतोऽस्मि परं पदम्। ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तमाविद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। So we are in the 58th class. Since this is the basic text, introductory text to Vedanta, therefore only I take each sentence, each vakya. This is in the prose form, therefore vakya, the sentence. I take each sentence vakya for one full class, or maybe sometimes more than that, like the definition of Atma or Sukshma Sharidam. It went for many classes because basic terminologies, definitions are covered in this text. The knowledge of this text is important for the study of Upanishads. Upanishad, take for granted that you have the knowledge of these basic terms. That is why I spend more time on each line. Okay, so that it is understood very clearly. Now we will chant. वासुदेवेन्द्रयोगीन्द्रम् गुरुम्
वासुदेवेन्द्रयोगीन्द्रम् नत्वा ज्ञानप्रदं गुरुम् मुमुक्षूणां हितार्थाय विधीयते
तत्त्वबोधो विधीयते
तत्त्वबोधो विधीयते। आई डिड दैट सॉरी।
तत्त्वबोधो विधीयते सूक्ष्म शरीरं किम्।
सूक्ष्म शरीरं किम्।
अपञ्चीकृत पञ्चमहाभूतैः कृतं सत्।
अपञ्चीकृत पञ्चमहाभूतैः कृत सत्।
कृतं सत् नट् कृत् सत् कृतं सत्
कृतं सत्
कर्मजन्यं
कर्मजन्यम्
सुखदुःखादिभोगसाधनम्
सुखदुःखादिभोगसाधनम्
पञ्चज्ञानेन्द्रियाणि पञ्चकर्मेन्द्रियाणि
पञ्चप्राणादयः मनश्चैकं बुद्धिश्चैका
एवं सप्तदश कलाभिः सह यत् तिष्ठति तत् सूक्ष्मशरीरम् श्रोत्रं त्वक् चक्षुरसना घ्राणमिति पञ्चज्ञानेन्द्रियाणि
श्रोत्रं त्वक्
क्षेत्रं चक्षुरसान घ्राणमिति पञ्चज्ञानेन्द्रियाणि
It is not kshetram, it is shrotram. Kshetram is different, shrotram is different. Kshetra is field, shrotram is ear. Not rasana, not rasana, it is rasana.
Rasana, rasana.
Chant properly, shrotram. Mistakes are there.
Shrotram.
Shrotrasya digdevata.
Shrotrasya digdevata.
Rafikan chant. Pachova yugo.
त्वचो वायुः
चक्षुषः सूर्यः रसनायाः वरुणः घ्राणस्य अश्विनौ इति ज्ञानेन्द्रियदेवताः
इति ज्ञानेन्द्रिय देवताः
श्रोत्रस्य विषयः शब्दग्रहणम्
श्रोत्रस्य विषयः शब्दग्रहणम्
तचो विषयः स्पर्शग्रहणम्
तचो विषयः स्पर्शग्रहणम्
चक्षुषो विषयः रूपग्रहणम्
चक्षुषो विषयः रूपग्रहणम्
रसनायाः विषयः रसग्रहणम्
रसनायाः विषयः रसग्रहणम्
घ्राणस्य विषयः गन्धग्रहणम् इति
घ्राणस्य विषयः गन्धग्रहणम् इति
पाक्पानि पादवायूपस्थानि इति पञ्च इन्द्रियाणि
वाक्पाणिपादपायुपस्पायु
इति पञ्चकर्मेन्द्रियाणि
इति पञ्चकर्मेन्द्रियाणि
पायुपस्थानि पायु प्लस् उपस्थानि पायुपस्थानि सवर्णदीर्घ
पायुपस्थानि
वाचो देवता वह्निः
वाचो देवता वह्निः
हस्तयोरिन्द्रः
हस्तयोरिन्द्रः
पादयोर्विष्णुः
पादयोर्विष्णुः
पायोर्मृत्युः
पायोर्मृत्युः
उपस्थस्य प्रजापतिः
उपस्थस्य प्रजापतिः
इति कर्मेन्द्रियदेवताः
इति कर्मेन्द्रियदेवताः
Up to this we saw last class. So this time covers the topic of Adhishthana Devata. Adhishthana Devata of both Karmendriya and Jnanendriya we have seen. What are the functions of these Karmendriyas? That is given in the next line which we will read. Functional field of each sense organ of action is given. Then repeat. Vacho Vishayaha Bhashanam.
Vacho Vishayaha Bhashanam.
पाण्योर विषयः वस्तु ग्रहणम्।
पाण्योर विषयः वस्तु ग्रहणम्।
पादयोर विषयः गमनम्।
पादयोर विषयः गमनम्।
पायोर विषयः मलत्यागः।
पायोर विषयः मलत्यागः।
उपस्थस्य विषयः आनन्दः इति।
उपस्थस्य विषयः विषय आनंद इति।
नॉट उपस्थस्य, उपस्थस्य विषयः आनंद इति और उपस्थस्य विषय आनंद इति। यू कैन रीड दिस वे आल्सो। यू स्प्लिट द संधि विषयः आनंदः इति।
यस
संधि इज व्हिच वी हैव नॉट सीन, यू विल सी लेटर। नाउ लेट मी एक्सप्लेन द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस लाइन। So Vishayaha, here the word Vishayaha doesn't mean subject matter. Here Vishayaha means the purpose, the Prayojanam. So the Prayojanam Vishayaha, Vishayaha means Prayojanam. Because the functional field of each sense organ of action is given by the author. Therefore, what is the purpose of each Karmendriya? It means what are the functions? It has got some prayojanam through activity. Through activity, activity you gain something, that is a prayojanam. What are they? That is given. The field of activity, that is the purpose, the prayojanam. Vachaha is speech, the organ of speech. What is the prayojanam of the organ of speech? Speech is speaking. Speech is the function, prayojanam of the organ of speech. Then what is the prayojanam, the purpose of pani? Pani is hand. Panyoho vishayaha vastu grahanam. Vastu means objects. Grahanam is grasping, holding. So the prayojanam, the usefulness of the hands is to hold objects. Is to hold objects. Hold means taking, keeping. By mistake you drop it because you can't hold. The holding, grasping, when you want to write, you have to take a pen, write, holding it, writing it. All these are the function of the hands. Pani is hand. Panihi pani panayaha. Ikarantaha pani shabdaha pullingaha, like arishabda. Then the function of the pada, padayoho. Why padayoho? Padayoho, two legs are there. Therefore padayoho dvivachanam. Shashti vibhakti. Ramayoho. Ramasya ramayoho ramanam. Padasya padayoho padanam. So padayoho. Padayoho, legs. Two legs are there, therefore dvivachanam. What is the prayojanam of the legs? Gamanam. Gamanam is movement, moving. Movement is the function of the legs. Payor vishayaha malatyagaha. Payu means that organ, payu, the organ of excretion. What is the function of that? Malatyagaha, removal of waste. Removal of waste from the body, that is the function of payu. Mala is impurity, tyaga is giving up. Therefore, removal of wastage from the body, that is the function of the payu, indriya, karmendriya, which is the organ of excretion, excretory organ. Then upasthasya vishayaha anandaha iti. Anandaha means pleasure. Upasthasya is genital organ. What is the sphere of activity of genital organ? It is anandaha. Iti. These are the functional. These are the functional field of the karmendriyas. So here Bhashanam, Vacho Vishayaha Bhashanam. Bhashanam means speaking. So the organ of speech, the organ of speech, does it do only speaking? Speaking is only a indicator, a upalakshanam. You speak, you sing, you do a lot of things through, not only speaking, speaking, singing, and whatever possible. So singing is also the function of Vagindriya. So Bhashanam is only Upalakshana. It only says speaking. Then you can include singing. Or you can include whistling. Whistle also. Whistling is also, you can, is possible. Whistling. Whatever is possible through both. Those are the function. Similarly, you can apply this to other other indriyas also, like gamanam, vastu grahanam. All these are, a particular activity is mentioned which covers all possible activities, which also covers all the possible activities of the sense organs. So what is given here? Bhashanam, grahanam, gamanam, malatya. It's only a indicator, upalakshana. All other activities which the karmendriya does, that have to be included. We say vastu grahanam. Vastu grahanam is holding. It can drop also. When you want to bowl in the cricket match, bowl, throwing the ball. That is the function of the hand, throwing, holding. So all the games, that disc throw, it's all the function of the hands. Similarly, the pada. Pada is gamanam, not only gamanam, not only movement. Movement in terms of you walk, you run, you do trekking, whatever possible through the pada. All the other actions are also covered. So these five organs of action, do they belong to the gross body, this karmendriya? No. Karmendriya refer to the power which is behind this each physical organ, because of which the physical organs are able to do their action. Because the karmendriyas are there, therefore the mouth can do bhashanam, can speak, can sing. Because the karmendriyas are there behind, the pani, the hands, can do vastu grahanam and all. So karmendriya is located, indriya is located behind the physical organ. Physical organs are called golaka. Okay. Now, Atma is, that is a topic. The topic is Atma. We should not forget the topic Atma. Atma is stula sukshma karana shariraat vitirittaha. Atma is distinct from stula shariram, sukshma shariram, and therefore we are discussing sukshma shariram. Because sukshma shariram has got all the 17 components, Atma is distinct from these 17 components. Distinct from the organs of action, distinct from the organs of knowledge. That is, Atma is different from Jnanendriya, Atma is different from Karmendriya. So Atma is distinct. Karmendriya should not be taken as Atma. Jnanendriya should not be taken as Atma. All the Indriyas are Atma, but Atma is not any one of them. That is why Sukshma Shariram is discussed. To negate that, don't confine Atma only to Sukshma Shariram. Sukshma Shariram is because of Atma, but Atma is not because of Sukshma Shariram. Sukshma Shariram has existence because of Atma. Minus Atma, Sukshma Shariram doesn't have existence. And this Sukshma Shariram has got all these components, 17 components. So Atma is not any of these components alone, not any of this Jnanendriya, Karmendriya, Pranas, etc. And because of Ajnanam, we identify strongly with each Karmendriya, each Jnanendriya. We identify with Jnanendriya, Karmendriya. When any organs are functioning, we say, I am not functioning. when you are not able to walk, you say, you don't say legs do not are not able to walk. You say I am not able to walk. The movement of the legs, the immobility of the legs is attributed to the Atma. The immobility of the hands is attributed to Atma. The function of the eye is to see. If eyes cannot see, you don't say eyes are not able to see. You say I am blind. The ears are not able to hear. You say I am deaf. That I is Atma. How can Atma be dumb or deaf? Yeah. The Jnanendriyas are not functioning. Because the Jnanendriyas do not function, how can you say Atma doesn't, Atma has a problem of vision, Atma has a problem of seeing. So, because we identify with the Indriyas, therefore, when they do not function, you say, I have problem. I have immobility. I am dumb. I am deaf. So, therefore, Atma is distinct, vyatiriktaha. Therefore, only it is discussed to show that Atma is distinct from this. So, therefore, Sukshma Shariram, we have seen the Sukshma Shariram is not. Sukshma Shariram is talked about, is discussed to understand that it is not Atma. Atma is Sukshma Shariram, but Sukshma Shariram is not Atma. And Sukshma Shariram has got all the 17 components. None of them is Atma, but Atma is everything. That is why we discussed. Now, because we discussed or discussing Sukshma Shariram, therefore, we have to discuss the other components also. What are the other components? Pranaha, Manaha, Buddhihi, they are there. But you see, the author doesn't discuss that. The author jumps to the next topic, Karana Shariram Kim. Another Sharira, the causal body. That topic it takes up. So here, the topic is not complete. Why? Because Sukshma Shariram has got the 17 components, Pancha Jnanendriyani, Pancha Karmendriyani, Pancha Pranadayaha, Manaschaikam, Buddhischaikam. Jnanendriya, Karmendriyas were discussed. What about Pranaha, Manaha, Buddhihi? Not discussed. So, since the author doesn't discuss these topics, maybe the author would have discussed, we would have lost those portion of the original manuscripts, that is also possible. So, therefore, for the sake of completion, we will discuss what are these pranas, pranadayaha, and what is this manas, mind. We will discuss for the sake of completion. Although we have discussed before, but not elaborately. And here also we will discuss just very briefly so that the topic is complete. So now, Pancha Pranaha. Now we have to supply. Ke Pancha Pranaha. We have to assume the student is asking. Ke Pancha Pranaha. What are Pancha Pranas? Then the Acharya answers. What are Pancha Prana? Prana, Apana, Vyana, Udana, Samanaha, Iti, Pancha Pranaha. It is not there in the text. We have to supply. Maybe it comes later, but for the sake of completion, as I said before, we are discussing pranas also. Pancha Prana, five pranas are there. The prana is energy. It is generally translated as energy or vital force. But prana is prana only. Let us not try to translate the word into English. So, prana, better to retain the word prana as prana. Because the translation, when you say energy or vital force, that sometimes it is misleading. So therefore, prana is prana. And as long as the prana is active in the body, prana is active in the body, the person is alive. The person is alive as long as the prana is functional, active. The moment the prana exits the body, leaves the body, because it is a part of sukshma shariram. Sukshma shariram leaves the body, that is called death. So, the moment the prana exits, that is called death. What is death? The shariram is said to be dead. Shava. Shariram becomes shava. So, prana is a general name. And the prana has got five pranas are there. Five pranas, the fivefold pranas correspond to the fivefold physiological functions of our biological system. They are pranaha, apanaha, vyanaha, udanaha, samanaha. So prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. When we take food, we do that. Om pranaya swaha, apanaya swaha. When we take food or when we do nevedyam to Bhagavan, we say this. Vyanaya swaha, udanaya swaha, samanaya swaha. By showing mudra, we offer the food to the Lord. We offer food to the Lord in our body. That is jata. That is Ishvara is there. Vaishvanaraha agnihi is there in our udaram. We offer this oblation into the agni. The agni is Vaishvanara agni in our stomach is a homakunda. So it is a yajna we do. So in the yajna we offer the agutis. Five agutis. Prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. These five pranas, they correspond to the five physiological functions. And they are together is called prana. So prana, the word prana stands for all the five pranas. So it's a general term. But as one of that, as one of the prana, as one of the five pranas, prana means, prana as one of the five pranas stands for the respiratory function of the system. It corresponds to the lung, the function of the lungs. So the nostrils are the openings through which the air is taken to the lung and from the lung to outside. So for inhalation and exhalation, this nostril is the opening. And the function of inhalation, exhalation takes place in the lung. It takes place in the lung and it is for the lung, not for the nostrils. Nostrils are only the path. So, the nostrils and the lung, they form the path of our respiratory system. Even the heart also, because the oxygen what we inhale, it's used for the purification of the blood. So, they form the prana, the respiratory function of the our biological system. So, five pranas, the first one is prana. The five pranas are put together is called prana. And the five prana, among the five pranas, the first one itself is a prana. That prana stands for the respiratory function of our system. Even in the Taittiriya Brahmana, it says pranaha rudaye. It is said pranaha rudaye. Prana is located in the heart. Prana is located in the heart. But prana is sensed. That prana, the air, it is sensed with the tip of the nose. Therefore, the tip of the nose is considered to be the seat of prana. That is why we keep our hand below the nose to check whether the person is alive. Because when there is no movement of hair, the tip of the nose, then we say, the person is not alive, he is dead. In fact, death is only an inference. How do you know a person is dead? Do you see a person? Do you see the sukshma shariram leaving the body through your eyes? Sukshma shariram is sukshma, it is subtle. It is not available for your gross perception. Eyes cannot perceive the sukshma shariram. ears cannot hear the sound of the sukshmashari iram leaving the body. Hands cannot touch and feel the sukshmashari because it is subtle. And then how do you know the person is dead? What is death? The departure of the sukshma shariram from the stula shariram is called death. Do you see sukshma shariram leaving the body? It is not available for your perception, any perception. But how do you say the person is dead? Death is also only an inference. You infer the person is dead. So you have to accept inference also as a pramana. So people who say God is not there, Bhagavan is not there, because they don't see. It's not available for the perception, not able to see, not available for my eyes, not available for ears. If somebody argues, then you have to ask the person, how do you know the person is dead? Do you see the person leaving the body? That is only inference. Similarly, Bhagavan is also can be inferred from this jagat. This jagat cannot come from somewhere else. This jagat, this world, this universe, it could not have come from somewhere else. It is inferred. That is, this jagat is there. Therefore, it must have a creator. Somebody would have creator. And the creator is Bhagavan. And the Bhagavan is not different from this universe. That is what the Shastram says. So you have to infer, because you see the jagat, you have to infer there must be the creator of the jagat, and that is Ishvara. As you infer the death of the person by placing your finger at the tip of the nose or by touching the nadi, the nerves, the nadi, you infer. Similarly, Bhagavan also can be inferred. So therefore, there is no point in saying, because you don't see God, therefore I won't accept God. That argument doesn't hold. It's an invalid argument. Many of our understanding or transaction are through inference. Inference is a very important pramana. And death is an inference. Doctors who are educated, they also confirm the death of the person only by inference. They don't see anything leaving the body. Even though the doctor may be a non-believer of God, because he doesn't see Bhagavan. But how does he see the death of the person? Does he see physically? No. That is also inference. So it's all common sense. It's all common logical thinking. So it is a stupid argument, because I don't see God, therefore I don't believe God. You cannot say. If you say, then I would say, because you don't see the departure of the person from the body, therefore you cannot say the person is dead. How do you say the person is dead? It is purely inference. So Bhagavan can be known through Shastram. He may not be available for your pratyaksha, but he can be inferred. And he can be known through Shastram. So Shastram is a pramanam. But if you have the unwillingness to accept Shastra pramanam, because you are a science student, you believe only in science, but you have to accept inference. Accepting inference is scientific. If you accept inference, by inference, you confirm the death of the person. By inference, you can also accept the existence of the Lord. What's the problem in that? Therefore, to say Bhagavan is not there is a stupid thing. He's there. It is, everything is Bhagavan. Because of Bhagavan only, everything functions, everything is what it is. Is, that itself is Bhagavan. So, therefore, the seat of prana is the tip of the nose. That is the power which functions behind the functioning, which powers, yeah, functioning behind this respiratory physical organ. It's called prana. Similarly, apana. Apana represents the the removal of wastage from the body. So the function which represents the removal of wastage from the body, that excretory system, water may be that solid or liquid or in the form of sweat, that is also a waste. It is done by apana. It is done by the prana called by the name apana. So the power which operates behind the functioning of our evacuatory physical organs is called by the name apana. The evacuatory need not be only in the form of evacuation, need not be only in the form of urine or solid waste. It can be through sweat. It can be through tears also. So, therefore, apana. Then vyana. Vyana represents the function of circulation. The circulation is very important. The blood has to be circulated. All the energy, vitamins and nutrition which is extracted from the food after assimilation, it has to be distributed throughout the body. So that is taken care by the vyana. Vyana stands for circulatory system. If eaten food is assimilated and remains in the stomach, what will happen? The stomach only will grow. Other organs will not grow, will not function. It has to be distributed. So you see how beautiful the system is. The food goes to the stomach, but stomach alone doesn't retain it. It distributes. Similarly, the money also, what we earn, it is meant for distribution. It is meant for doing dhanam. That is beautifully, you can see in our own body itself, it is there. Then only all the limbs, all the parts of the body function. Similarly, then only the society will function if you only do dhanam, distribute what we earn. Not everything, a portion of our earnings is given for the good purpose. Then only the society also will be healthy. As the body has to be healthy. When do you say the body is healthy? Only when all the organs function, all the limbs are healthy. Then only the body is healthy. Not any part of the limb is healthy. You don't say the body is healthy. All the parts of the body has to be healthy. Even if one part is not healthy, you say the body is not healthy. Similarly, the money also. Money or water may be contribution. The contribution need not be only monetary. It can be in the form of knowledge. It can be in the form of time. It can be in the form of effort. That one has to contribute. One has to be a contributor. One has to be a contributor, not just a consumer. Our stomach is not just a consumer. It consumes and it contributes to all the parts of the body. All the parts of the body. It circulates the vitamins, the energy, the nutrients, whatever it assimilates. So the distribution of nutrition or the circulation of blood to all the parts of the body, it is taken care by the prana, which is called by the name vyana. So vyana is the shakti which operates behind this circulatory system. So the seat of vyana is the entire body. The entire shariram is the seat of vyana. Then comes udana, the fourth one. Udana represents the shakti. That operation is very unique. Udana doesn't function normally. Udana means it does the reverse function. It reverses the normal function. That's why it is unique. Like the food is meant for eating. You eat the food and goes to the stomach. The stomach digests the food and assimilates and distributes. Suppose the food is not digested, what will happen? The stomach, if you cannot take the food, then it just throws out in the form of vomiting. It doesn't happen every time. It happens at some particular time or when food is not proper, when the stomach cannot take the food because the intake is not proper or the intake is more, then it is ejected out through the mouth. So the udana, Udana is like a emergency exist. So it is the emergency exist. When something is abnormal, when food cannot reach the stomach, it cannot go down the stomach. So it has to be pushed out. That is done by Udana. The prana is called Udana. So Udana is important. So Udana is emergency exit. And this Udana also functions at the time of death, the final departure. The jiva is from the body, it is ejected out through this prana called Udana. So Udana is active not all the time. At some time when the food is ejected, when the food is thrown out, vomited out, and at the time of death, at these two instances, Udana is active. This is the function of Udana. Then Samana. Then comes the last one, Samana. Samana represents the digestive function. Samana represents the digestive function. It is responsible for the assimilation of food and converts into energy and nutrition, which the body can absorb. These are the Pancha Pranarayaha, which the author has not discussed, but we are discussing it so that it is complete. And Manashchekam Buddhishcheka, that we will see in the next class. So we will stop here. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Dhanyavad Guruji.
Dhanyavad Guruji.
Dhanyavad Guruji.
Dhanyavad Guruji.
Dhanyavad.